The whole point of making this film was to pay homage to the song Happy Christmas, War is Over.
So this is Christmas, and what have you done?
Yes, this is Christmas song, but this is an anti-war song. This is a protest song. It's why we didn't make a Christmas or holiday short. We made an anti-war short.
Well, I wanted to do something that was unconventional. There was talk of doing a more traditional music video, but I felt that because the song it was so known and loved already, that it wasn't necessary to come out with just visual accompaniment to a song that's known and loved.
The same for all of us here is that you want to do right by this song. And you know, you actually told me a lot about the song that I didn't know, and just the way your parents made it into this perennial thing. And once we had the conversation about the song, it really kind of dawned on me, like, oh man, this is a really big deal.
And if you think Dave was nervous, I was especially nervous. Yes. Because for me, my yeah. parents are sort of monolithic. I mean, they're not just yeah. John and Yoko, the musicians, but they're my mom and dad. So I have yeah. so much love and adoration, and I want to sort of do good by their art. So I had the pressure too, to be honest.
We had Vicki, Hiatt, who is our music supervisor, and she had been working with Temp Score and all sorts of, like, all of our different versions of the film. She somehow would put it back together and make it all make sense. And, you know, she was such a great collaborator on this.
The challenge of working in the part of the movie that I do is that the movie is changing a lot, and that you want it to feel every time you get a new edit that nothing changed, that the music is still working.
And so there were points in this film where I was just like, my gosh, you know, what have I done? Because we were struggling with things like how the music was gonna be. And then Thomas came in and basically completely blew our minds and saved the whole thing.
Everything clicked into place.
I think there was a small window we had.
Like 3 weeks or something?
Yeah. But oftentimes that's great to just come in and you kind of cut away all the kind of who knows into the, like, I better get something happening quickly. Yeah. And it was, you know, sometimes it works out, and it's always great when it does.
To find the right place to bring in the song was oddly the hardest part of making the film. And the more we worked on the story, the harder it got to place it in the film. So we tried it earlier, we tried it later. And at one point, Sean said, you know, look, if we need to just play it over the credits, let's just play it over the credits.
It was difficult to place the song because when it hits, ideally, it has to hit really strong.
The idea was that the song had to work. I mean, the song was coming at the end of this thing. And how could you support the story and at the same time allow for the song stylistically? I think yeah. that was the big challenge.
Yeah, and you know, we had a lot of conversations about, oh, do we try and echo the song? And you know, you had very strong feelings about that right off the bat. You're like, no, just let it, like, we're gonna do the score and the song's gonna be the song.
Well, I mean, you always wonder, okay, what's the style of a song? What's the instrumentation of a song? And should that relate to the color and instrumentation of a score? And typically, experientially, the answer is no. You don't, because that becomes precious and it becomes kind of a foregone idea as opposed to what is the content of the story and the style of the animation, etc. And then you just, you know, you kind of find your way by eliminating and I guess I call it like allowable vocabulary. Because oftentimes that's the best way to decide if you like something, is to say, here's something, here's a bit of music against an image. Here's another piece of music against the same image. Which do I like more and why?
The first time we met here and we were hearing the score, well, it wasn't even really score yet. It was like a sketch, like a musical sketch that you put against picture. And you know, we were talking about this earlier where it's just like, that was so informative because we were able to very quickly kind of put this idea up that was really about emotion. We had that conversation right off the bat, and I feel like we honed it in really quickly from that, because there's things that you were important to you, there's things that are important to us.
Right, and then you want to do it early enough so that I'm not defending ideas and you're kind of digging your heels because I'm pushing them at you. So, I mean, that's the nature of how three people, four people can collaborate, is if I put forth an idea and say, what do you think? And you feel like room to say, I like this, but can it change here? Then you make quicker work of it.
The style of the music, what you're hearing now in the final form of the music, is very different than what we used when we were working on the show in the early days. We had a track that is called a temp track, but it didn't sound anything like Tom Newman's score.
The score is, you know, especially with a film with no dialogue, it's 50% of your experience.
Yeah, I mean,
yes,
yeah,
we have sound, of course, which is a huge part of that, but the score is really the emotional voice of our characters. You know, you'll listen to temp music. I think a lot of directors go through this. You listen to temp music, you're used to the temp music. Now, in my head, some of your music was the temp music, so that was really helpful. But you hear it for the first time, and you have to immediately deprogram, what, like a year and a half of programming?
That's shocking, right?
Yeah.
It's really shocking.
And I remember the feeling, because I was like, okay, shut up. Like, telling my brain to shut up for a minute and actually listen, and then you get past that experience very quickly and go, okay, this is what this film's going to be. What's becoming.
Really good directors, there's like a moment where you just have to, I don't know what I think of this, but I think I like it. And that you just have to hope that that door opens or closes, as opposed to saying, no, this makes me uncomfortable and I can't accept it because of this year and a half I've been living with something. Yes. But I think the best directors are always gonna say, I wanna tilt towards my next step moving forward, as opposed to I'm too afraid to do that.
Being so
it's a real moment of leadership, I think, to say, yeah, I believe in this enough to get over my utter terror that it's the wrong choice.
In these meetings here, working with you and your team, to me it was like the most fun on the project, because in a way, it's like, you know, directing up to this point, everything's kind of in my control to a certain point, like you're saying.
Yeah.
But I get here and it's just like, here's my 6-month-old baby, please take care of it.
I know, I get it. It's gotta be hard to be a director and to say, I don't like this. To tell students and stuff, imagine being a director and what do you say?
If you are the type of person that is generous, and when things are going well and people are doing a great job and you're generous with that feedback, when you give the hard feedback, which has to happen to create anything, people feel safer that you're not trying to tear them down. You made me feel that way when I was here, because I felt like I was safe with you. And,
yeah.
And that's it's very emotionally whatever, but it's important, and man, what a great experience. So thank you.
Oh, thank you.